Alright, trickers and trickers, time to take a look at the final episode of the day, which is... What is it called again? Oh yeah. Which is By Inferno's Light. The Dominion fleet enters the Alpha Quadrant through the wormhole. The OSIS defined Ducat's vertebrae and the station's two remaining runabouts prepared to take on the fleet, only for it now to attack Deep Space Nine, and instead heads directly for Cardassian space. Ducat's vertebrae breaks off from the Defiant and starts to fill the Dominion fleet. Kira, thinking Ducat is trying to be a hero, tells him to return to the formation, but Ducat clarifies he isn't chasing the fleet, he's joining it, and then reveals a startling fact. Over the last few months, he has been conducting secret negotiations and, as a week earlier, the Cardassian Union has officially become members of the Dominion. He then whispers to Kira, rarely knowing that the two of them being on the same side never seemed right. He then makes a getaway before the Defiant can destroy his ship. Ugh. Worf, Bashir, Garak, and Martok plan their escape from internment camp 371. Bashir tells the group that Garak, a man of many hidden talents, is their only hope to reconfigure the transmitter to contact the runabout and beam them out. The prisoners in internment camp 371 are gathered together. The prisoners commanding Vorta Deos notice that Cardassia has joined the Dominion, and, consequently, all the Cardassians in prison 371 are being released, with the exception of Garak. When Garak demands to know why he's not being released, Deos explains that this is because he's not popular with the new head of the Cardassian government, who was none other than Gul Dukat. Ducat soon makes his first broadcast as leader to the people of Cardassia, while Sisko and Leers watch on DS9. Ducat promises with the help of their Dominion allies that within 5 days, he'll remove and kill all Klingons and Maquis from within Cardassian space, as well as anyone who gets in the way of Cardassia's return to a position of prominence in the Alpha Quadrant. The senior staff discuss the situation. The wormhole's entrance, rather than being sealed, has now been strengthened to the point that it can never be collapsed, not even with lithium explosives. Between this and the sudden disappearance of a Bajoran engineering officer, changing involvement is suggested by none other than the Julian Bashir changeling. With this, he is authorized by Sisko to begin blood screenings. While Garak works inside tight space next to their cell to conduct the runabout's transporter, Worf is coerced into a series of hand-to-hand battles with Geminar warriors, beginning with the youngest and most inexperienced. Back in the Alpha Quadrant, Kira and Xial talk on the promenade, discussing the duplicitous actions of her father, Ducat. A battered Klingon fleet led by Chancellor Galron unsplendorized at DS9. The other Dominion fleet has quickly turned the tide of the Cardassian War in favor of the Cardassians, and they insist Galron is ready to plunge the Klingon Empire into a fight to death with the Dominion. Sisko suggests to Gowron that the Kinemar Accords be revived for the sake of bolstering their forces for the coming conflict. Gowron accedes. Afterwards, the Bashir changeling successfully sneaks aboard the runabout USS Yukon and begins making modifications to the runabout's console. Worf continues fighting the Geminar and kills at least one of the five, running on admiration from Martok. Once back in the cell, Bashir treats Worf and says that he has 3 or 4 broken ribs. The doctor recommends that Worf stop fighting, but Worf refuses. Garak is still working inside the tight space, talking to himself, and seems to be losing his mind. The others hear strange noises coming from within the space. When the Geminar guards pass the cell, the prisoners hurriedly shut off the power, plunging the enclosed space into darkness. When the guards have gone, Bashir enters the space and pulls Garak out. For the next several hours, he lies on his bunk, unmoving, staring straight ahead. Bashir grimly says that Garak's claustrophobia has overcome him, and will be unable to try contacting the runabout. The staff aboard DS9 is waiting for reinforcements. Kira enters ops and says that security blocks to one of the industrial replicators at level 17 was overridden, and the memory core has been wiped, so they don't know what was replicated. Sisko orders that Odo increase security, and if he needs some more men, to ask Chancellor Gowron to sign additional Klingon troops. Sisko is contacted by Gul Dukat, who has been declared the head of the new Cardassian government. Dukat recommends that the Federation join the Dominion, which Sisko says no to. Dukat then explains how he swore that all Cardassia had lost, would be regained and lays claim to DS9, since built by a Cardassian, and gives Sisko an ultimatum. Either he surrenders the station, or Dukat will take it by force. Cisco tells him he's more than welcome to try and terminate his communications. Martok assists Worf back to the cell, returning from his seventh hand-to-hand victory. Bashir patches him up as best he can, and Martok pledges to commission an epic song about Worf's trials. Bashir has a journal to be sure to send him a copy, and Martok says he could do better. He can ensure Bashir's command rate as well as the healer that bound the warrior's wounds so he could fight again. Worf rather remarks that the only part of the song he wants to hear is the part that tells of their escape. Bashir grows grave and says that, with the Garak out of action, they need to come up with a new plan. To everyone's surprise, Garak rises from his bunk and cheerfully says that won't be necessary. He has no intention of appearing Martok's song, as a Cardassian who panicked in the face of danger. He's rested enough, and it's time for him to get back to work inside his dungeon. As he ducks into the cramped space again, the two Klingon warriors look on with respect, both knowing that it takes true courage to face one's own worst fears. The Julian Bashir changeling and O'Brien talk in the infirmary. O'Brien is shocked when Bashir talks excitedly about having purchased Deridium alloy darts at a time like this, but does not suspect that Bashir is a changeling. Worf, back at the combat area, is waiting for his next opponent. Modios and the gentleman are first. Ikad Ika arrive instead. Ikad Ika announces that he will fight Worf himself. Meanwhile, Garak is back in the crawl space when Jupiter's soldiers come in the cell looking for him. Find the drill that's used to open the panel to the space where Garak is. Sisko orders Kieran Dax to the Defiant for the impending battle and deploys the runabouts. The Jupiter changing is on the runabout USS Yukon and responds to ops in a female voice, having already incapacitated the original crew. O'Brien notices that the belt of tachyon particles has been detected, and ships begin to cloak in around the station. Romulan ships. The Romans request permission to join the fleet. Sisko, while quite surprised, grants their request. Kira on the Defiant states that the Cardassian Dominion fleet is merely 10 minutes away. Bashir tries to bluff the Jumbotar soldier about the tool by hoping, saying it's either a self-sealing stem bolt or a reverse ratcheting router. Not convinced, the soldiers vaporize a Romulan prisoner and then threatens to kill another if Bashir continues to lie. Before the leader can kill Bashir for his insolence, another soldier figures out the tool's use. In the ring, Worf is losing the fight against Ikad Ika, and can barely stand. When he's knocked down yet again, Martok urges him to yield, insisting that honor has been satisfied. Garak is close to being discovered when a brain prisoner grabs a plasma pistol from the holster of a Jupiter who had his back turned and vaporizes two of the guards. The second manages to vaporize him as well. Bashir and the Romulan prisoner kill the remaining guards with makeshift knives and grab their weapons, urging Garak to complete his work before Jupiter reinforcements storm into the cell. In the ring, Worf is clearly beaten, but still refuses to yield. As he crawls on his belly toward the post, even Ikad Ika tries to dissuade him from continuing, saying that Worf has proven his worth, but Worf still refuses to yield, and Deus orders the combat finished. Instead, Ikad Ika steps back and yields the match, announcing that he may be able to kill Worf, but he cannot defeat him, which no longer interests him. Deus orders them both executed. Just as the guards raise their weapons, Garak sees activating his makeshift communicator, learning about it immediately energizes his transporter, beaming all the prisoners away. As the guards open fire, Ikad Ika is vaporized by a plasma bolt, but Worf is swinging away a split second before the weapon's fire impacts him. Aboard the runabout, Garak immediately lays an escape course, while Martok and Bashir help a badly injured Worf to one of the cabins in the back. Before going, Worf makes sure to tell the Cardassian that he did well, and Garak returns the compliment. The crew then set a course back to the station at maximum warp. Back on DS9, everyone is confused by the lack of an attacking fleet contrary to the sensor readings. Suddenly, they get a parting message from the real Bashir in the Gamma Quadrant. Sisko quickly realizes that the Bashir they've been dealing with was a changeling and quickly discerns that he left aboard the runabout Yukon. He then contacts the fight and orders Kira to destroy the runabout no matter the cost. Kieran Dax determined that the changeling has rigged the Yukon with trilithium, Tekasite, and proto-matter, which, if dead inside the Bajoran sun, would induce a supernova, destroying Bajor, the DS9, and the combined Klingon, Romulan, and Federation fleets all in one fell swoop. The Divine warps towards the sun and tractors the Yukon away just in time to prevent the supernova. It dives off into free space and explodes, killing changeling and incapacitated crews still aboard. The sensor readings of the Dominion fleet suddenly vanish. Cisco realizes that the whole incident was a plot to lure the combined fleets of the Alpha Quadrant superpowers to the Bajoran system and then blow them all up together with Bajor and Deep Space Nine. Yet the plan failed and Armageddon had to wait for another day. At Quark's, Garak and Zeal emotionally reunite as they're Jackson Worf in the infirmary. Meanwhile, Chief O'Brien is about to realize he has been hanging around with the changing for the last 4 weeks. He tells the real Bashir, who is now cleaned up and switched to the uniform style, that he should know something was up with his changing replacement. It was a lot easier to get along with. On the second level of the promenade, Garak signs the final version of the new treaty between the Federation and the Klingon Empire, which includes a new permanent Klingon military presence on DS9. Sisko is given the right to choose the commander himself, and considering Worf and Martok's mutual admiration, he asks the general if he'd be up for the job, which he gladly accepts. T'Kata contacts Sisko to congratulate him on preventing mass destruction. Sisko points out that Zayal would have died along with them if the bomb had gone off on the Bajoran sun. But the new leader of Cardassia does not seem to be bothered, seeing that she made her choice, and that no longer considers her his daughter. Ooh, that's mean, man. T'Kata tells Sisko that he may have escaped defeat today, but tomorrow... We will see about that, the captain interrupts. Yes, we will, T'Kata replies, ending the transmission. Ooh, boy. So, let's take a look at some trivia surrounding this episode. This episode deals with two major story arcs which had originally been introduced in previous episodes. The Klingon War, which began with the Warrior and was seen throughout Season 4, is officially ended by Gowron when he re-signs the Kittim Accords and once again allies the Klingon Empire with the Federation. Also part of this arc is the presence of General Martok, who was presumed dead after the revelation that he had been replaced by a changeling in Apocalypse Rising. The Dominion War, which had existed in the state of Cold War since the second season finale of the Jem'Hadar, becomes a more urgent matter with the advancement of the Dominion fleet into the Alpha Quadrant and T'Kata's decision to have Cardassia become a member. This episode marks the second time that Bashir is discovered to be replaced by a changeling, the first being the Adversary. There are great references to previous episodes. Forces are divided Jem'Hadar as revealed into the death here is here realized. The Dominion fleet headed towards Bajor, but then turning and moving towards Cardassia, confirms Sisko's visions of Locusts and Rapture. T'Kata's reference to himself and Kira being on the same side refers to indiscretion and return to grace. The reference is to Cardassian cultural depression and economic stagnation, and T'Kata's promise to eliminate all Klingon troops in Cardassian territory, across the events of the Way of the Warrior. T'Kata's reference to Sisko saving his life more than once, first in the episodes of the Maquis Part 2, where Sisko rescues T'Kata from the Maquis in the Way of the Warrior, when Sisko helps T'Kata save Cardassia before the Klingon fleet arrives. This episode shows the audience the third honorable Jem'Hadar first, Ikat Ika. The first was Goran Agar in the episode Hippocratic Oath. The second was Omed Iklan in To the Death. Others would include Ramata Klan in Rocks and Shoals, Xana Rocks in One Little Ship, although neither of them actually held the rank of first, for the Ramata Klan being enacted commander first was killed, and Xana Rocks serving under first Gudag Eitan. This episode, the seemingly strange decision on the part of the Jem'Hadar to leave their runabout orbiting internment camp 371 will later be addressed by Luther Sloan of Section 31 in the episode Inquisition, though it does not explain the Dominion's reason for doing so. In the episode of The Homecoming, it was established that a runabout's transporter could only beam up two subjects at a time. That limitation was overcome by this episode, as the runabout was able to beam up far more than two. However, there has been no on-screen explanation as to how. It's also possible that only two people were transported at a time, and the way in which the sequence was cut made it appear they were transported simultaneously. We see Garak transported, followed by Worf and Martok, and finally by Bashir and the Romulan prisoner. We see Bashir and the Romulan materialize on the runabout, however. Garak is standing at the flight controls. Worf and Martok are standing off to side transporter, and all three are fully materialized. It's possible Garak's people programmed the runabout to transport himself aboard, then beat Worf and Martok as soon as he was aboard, followed by Bashir and the Romulan. Worf is shot during the transport in the same manner in which Hayes was killed in Countdown, yet he seemed unaffected. If their 21st century transporters have been improved over their 22nd century counterparts, the shield people were not kind of damaged. Worf was further along in the transport process, and there was less of him still there to take damage. Dax isn't about jumping to warp inside the Bajoran star system. In Star Trek The Motion Picture, Captain Kirk had to risk jumping to warp inside Earth's solar system to intercept Voyager as soon as possible. Excuse me. The shots of Dukat addressing the Cardassian people on view screens are modified from Tribunal, Dukat's image replacing that of Chief Archon Machbar. Dukat's line to Ziel at the end of In Purgatory's Shadow, "Stay or be damned," parallel to Kang and Blood Oath. This all reveals that, like Kang, he was hiding the fact that he was collaborating with the enemy. Unlike Kang, he does not redeem himself in the remaining hour. Rene Auberjonois and Kira Glofton do not appear in this episode. Though Odo is mentioned by Kira when she tells Sisko about how the Salvador overrode the security blocks on the industrial replicator, and again by Sisko, when he ordered security to be increased. Ikat Ika is the only Jem'Hadar to appear in more than one episode. The Romulans joined the Federation Klingons near Deep Space Nine to prevent the station from the Dominion. The appearance of the Romulans foreshadowed their eventual alliance with the Federation and Klingon Empire during the Dominion War. This marks the final time any of the Deep Space Nine cast is seen wearing the Starfleet uniform that debuted in the premiere episode Emissary. In this case, the real Jean Bashir, but the original design-style uniforms would continue to be used for the duration of Star Trek Voyager as the Voyager crew are stuck in the Delta Quadrant. So overall, this is a really damn good episode, and yeah, I'm finally glad that the Federation and Klingons are now allies again, so yay! So overall, I give By Inferno's Light 5 warp cores out of 5. Well, anyway, tune in tomorrow as we wait till the next episode. Dr. Bashir, I presume. So, until then, live long and prosper, everybody.